It's time to go.
Go?
It's time to go. The button says, it's time to go. And so I always listen to the button when it says, it's time to go. I believe it is time to go. So, hello everyone. Welcome to Wednesday live stream here with Primetime Aquatics. Glad you are here. Hope you can hear us. Hope you can see us. Hope you're having a wonderful evening and a good week so far. Thank you for being here. This is awesome. Like we always say, this is one of our favorite parts of the week, and it's all because of you. And so we're looking forward to a really cool night. We've got some announcements we're going to talk about before we get into things. Hold on, let me fix all my electronics I got going on here. Okay, awesome. All fixed up.
Yeah, you're like war games over here.
I know. I've got lots of electronics, and yours is just currently not doing what it's supposed to do. So tonight's topic is snails. Some people love them. Some people despise them. And then there are some people who are indifferent to them. Mm. I don't know what hurts the snails' feelings the most. The people who really don't like them but care enough about them to despise them, or the ones who are just like, eh, they're snails. They just walk by the tank and the poor snail's like, man, he never really says anything about me.
Yeah, I suppose not. People probably don't have a whole lot of
favorite snails. Come check out my tank. Look at all these pest snails that I have in here, right? I'm just collecting them for fun. It's my only tank, and that's all I have in there. So some of my tanks have been like that. And some of you know, especially in some of the earlier videos, we'd get questions like that all the time. Like, do you have anything in this tank besides snails? Well, I do in theory, but the snails are kind of overrunning things. And so tonight, we're going to talk about all kinds of snails. We're going to talk about snails that you buy on purpose. We're going to talk about snails that wind up in your tank by accident. We're going to talk about if you want to keep them, how to do that. If you want to get rid of them, how to do that. So I realize there is a lot of diversity here when it comes to snails and what they can provide or not provide to your tank. So a couple cool things before we get started, right? Mm. Thingy number one is your video today. It's not about a fish tank on the small scape that came out this morning. It's right behind it. Is it still back there?
It is.
Okay. I can't really see it. Is it right behind your head?
It's like...
So it's over there somewhere.
Right there.
But anyway, it's a combination of like a paladarium slash this big, huge...
It is a paladarium.
Well, it is a paladarium.
It's part water, part land, but there's some cheats in there. And it's labeled fairy garden, but there's only two little portions of it that are fairy garden. The rest of it's just a really cool bunch of cheats and hacks in there that are hidden.
It's pretty cool. If you haven't seen it, I sometimes wonder how you imagine these things before you make them. I would have just made a paladarium with rocks in the center, but the video would have taken like 3 seconds. I'd be like, there you go. That's it. It would have been awesome. A couple other things.
If you were ever to make a fairy garden, it would be a pile of rocks with a little fairy on top.
No, it probably would like a pile of rocks, and there'd be like, I don't know, some like Sauron or something like that. Sauron, the Lord of the Rings guy, and they'd be like, there's my fairy garden.
Oh, that's a
well, that's not a fairy garden. It's full of orcs. Yeah, that's just how I make them.
Scary.
Friday's video on Primetime Aquatics is going to be a very different video. It's something I've never done before, but I felt like doing it. So we'll see how it works out. Would love to hear your feedback. So if you watch the video on Friday, really want to hear if it's something you like, you want more, and if you don't, just be like, nah, I prefer you just to stay with what you normally do.
I would suggest that you pack yourself a lunch and buckle up.
Yeah, it's a little bit more lengthy, but I hope it's just something different, something that I like I said, we haven't done before, so hopefully you like it. The other cool thing is new merch. We've got some new things coming out. We were hoping that they would be here today and that we would be able to make an announcement that we had some new cool things happening, but they're not quite here, but any day now, probably this week still, we will have cool new stuff. And we branched out a little bit, and so hopefully you will find it kind of interesting, but as soon as that happens, we will let you know. And then one last thing before we get into the topic, and that is if you want to learn more about snails, check out the description below, because I've put basically all the snail videos that I've done in the description below for your viewing pleasure, in case you want more information on how to breed stuff, specific examples on how to get rid of things. So, yeah. What's so funny?
James Manning said a bearded fairy.
A bearded fairy.
They probably have cute... They're called gnomes.
There you go.
Right here, I have my very own gnome.
So before we get into things, I saw some stuff come through. First of all, Dave from Iowa, thank you for becoming a member.
Welcome.
And I will definitely answer your question in the super chat. Thank you for that. So we've got that kind of set aside for when we get to that part. Tank Top Tropics.
I got it. I figured it out.
Thank you so much for the sticker as we get started. And then Jack Blackman, welcome to being a primetime member. Glad you are here. Thank you for that.
Yay.
Okay, snails.
Snails.
Now, when you first started hanging out in the fish room, you had a very, would you say, you really weren't crazy of the snails, right? And to a certain extent, you're still not crazy about snails.
I honestly did not like them. I hated them. They're gross. I wouldn't even touch one. But now I have peat puffers and I got to touch them.
So would you say that at this point, in terms of snails, you like them or not like them?
I like mystery snails. They're very relaxing to watch. And like in the tank behind me, it's very conducive to putting a little ram's horn snail in. So when it's just a little individual, little one snail, get my gist? I don't mind them.
But you don't like the piles of snails?
No.
Okay. Bonnie, thank you so much for the super chat. Thank you so much for being here. Glad you're here. Glad you're hanging out with us. Okay, so snails. There are lots of different types, right? We're going to cover some of the different types today. We've got things like mystery snails where they're big and they're colorful and they're awesome. And we've done videos on how to care for them. You've got the nerite snails, which are also really cool. In fact, they even show more variation when it comes to like the patterns on their shells. Stay a little bit smaller. Those are really awesome. In fact, we did a video where we compare the two. And then you've got like the assassin snails, which we're going to talk about more later. But those, generally speaking, are the snails that most people get on purpose. They buy them and they're like, yes, I want these in my tank. Then there's the other side of things. The dark side. There is the dark side.
The snails.
And that is the pest type snails that most people typically think are pest type snails, like the ram's horn snails, Malaysian trumpet snails, your bladder snails slash pond snails. And those ones are the ones that usually a lot of people don't introduce them into their tanks on purpose, although some do, and I sometimes will. But a lot of people are like, man, you know what? I had this tank and everything was going great. And then I added some stuff, some plants, and I saw this one little cute snail and I was like, oh, that's nice. And then all of a sudden I saw three more. And then like a week later, I saw 500 and then there was 1,000. Then pretty soon there was no water in my tank. It was just all snails, right? So that is, there's a big diversity there. Now, issues when it comes to snails. I think the biggest one is what I just explained, especially for the pest type snails. And that is people are afraid that they're going to grow out of control because that's not a, like an unfounded type of concern, because if they can sometimes grow absolutely out of control, you get a massive population. We're going to talk about how to control that later, but I think most people probably wouldn't mind them if they had this beautiful planted tank, like, oh yeah, got some ram's horn snails in there and there's like five and there's always been five and they're kind of, they do their thing and they just, I don't know what happens, they just seem to be under control and it's not a big deal. Problem is, like I said, we get lots and lots of them, and so that could be an issue. And of course, when that happens, it doesn't necessarily look great, especially if you're into like the planet takes the nice aquascapes. Like, yep, I also have a big giant pile of snails every time I feed my fish and they're all over the place. Of course, some snails will eat plants. Now here, we have to be careful because, and I always use the example of like the mystery snail tank that we have. We actually put plants in that tank on purpose because we want the snails to clean off some algae, even some blackbeard algae. If you get enough snails in a smaller area, they clean off everything. The roots, they clean off the leaves. Mm-hmm. Granted, we have plants that have thicker leaves, and usually in those tanks, like Crips and Anubias. I think they've left, we've had Jungle Val in there before. They leave that alone. Hornwort, they pretty much have left that alone. Although I do find that they will eat duckweed. They eat all the algae in that tank. That tank is spot-free, algae-free. And I guess you'd probably want to be a little bit more careful about maybe some sword plants that might be a little bit weaker and maybe they're just starting to make it through and there's a little bit of melt. But we've had really no issues with snails eating healthy plants, at least for the beginner plants that we keep. That has not been an issue. Could snails eat some plants that maybe have really thin leaves or maybe they're dying back a little bit? Sure, that can happen. But for all of their scary features, there are also some good things. And that is, I think the, one of the number one things is, obviously, if you're getting mystery snails and nerite snails, they look cool, right? Most people get those things because they like the colors, they like the patterns. And it was funny, was it one of the videos that we did, we talked about like the goofiest tank inhabitants. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember if the mystery snails actually made it on that list or if people, but I remember people commenting on that video and saying, mystery snails are really goofy. They're really fun to watch. They kind of slide their way up the side of a tank. They get to the top and like, oh man, I'm not going to crawl all the way back down again. I'm just going to fall. And they just kind of do the falling thing. And so, it can be like a relaxing, fun thing to do. Marty, thank you so much for the super chat. Snails in a discus tank. I haven't kept discus in so long. I don't know if they eat them. So if someone is, you know, I'm sure they would probably pick on the extraneous parts that are hanging out of the shell, not just being a cichlid, but I'm not really sure. So if you try it out, I'd love to know how what happened. Yeah, I put in $20 worth of mystery snails. It turned out to be some really good food for the discus. Probably not going to do that again. So the other cool thing about snails, no matter what type of snail, is algae control. So think about it this way. You're converting something that's unsightly, right? The algae. The snails are eating that and converting that to biomass. And yes, depending on the snail, they may use that to reproduce, but you're probably going to get less snail production, that large biomass, than you will algae production. So if you really don't like algae, trade it off for something that you might not like a little less, right? Or you might like a little more, or not like not more or less. Yeah, you understand what I'm saying.
No. Oh, but go ahead.
Anyway, the other cool thing is the Malaysian trumpet snails. I think what's cool about them, and we did a video about them, is a lot of times you don't actually see them when the lights are on. Like you'll turn the lights on right away, and if you got a bunch of Malaysian trumpet snails like we do in some of our tanks, they're like covering the glass, they're covering wood, they're covering your plants. It's like, I didn't realize I had 68,000 Malaysian trumpet snails in this 10-gallon tank, but they all go away. And it's probably like, you know, they go back into the substrate and the substrate like increases by a half inch as they all kind of burrow in there. So that's kind of cool that they can be not as visible when the lights are on. So it's kind of like the best of both worlds. You're getting the algae control, maybe some of the detritus control when the lights are off. And then when the lights are on, they just go right back under the substrate for the most part. And you don't really see them. And they can kind of turn over that substrate. So if you're one of those people who worry a little bit about gas pockets in your substrate, well, the Malaysian trumpet snails might be able to help you out a little bit, I think.
But don't go to your tanks at night because the substrate actually is moving.
But I actually find that kind of interesting. Wasn't there like a movie? What movie was it where like the ground was moving? There was like something under the ground. I don't remember what that was. That's kind of like what your Malaysian trumpet snails will do, especially if you've got like fine gravel. You just see it kind of moving around. You're like, why is my substrate alive? It's alive. Beetlejuice?
There's a part in Beetlejuice.
That's not what I remember. Desert Fish, thank you so much for the super chat. Hi, J&J. Got my first 3-pack of Cottlepunks in the 29-gallon breeding tips. We're going to get to that. Remember that question, please. And we're going to talk about Cottlepunks later, I promise. Thank you so much. All right. So other things that I think are pretty cool. Well, I think this is kind of interesting. And that is, believe it or not, in our fish room, and again, we've got a lot of tanks. So I think I would notice it more if I just had one tank. Dune, that was the answer. Yeah. And Tremors. Thank you. Dune and Tremors. Yeah.
There we go.
So it's kind of like Dune and Tremors mixed into one. That's what your Malaysian trumpet snails are doing. But I think one of the interesting things is if you have a tank where you've got some smaller fish in that tank, and one of them happens to just pass along, right? It was his time to go. If you've got stuff like Malaysian trumpet snails or ram's horn snails, there's a good chance you're not even going to know that fish passed away because the snails will often take care of it. Like we have so many scavenger fish in a lot of our tanks between the snails and the bristlenose plecos, smaller fish, like, you know, if you've got neons or even I've seen them like take care of a molly. Like, you know, you walk down there, you're in a hurry in the morning, like, oh my gosh, there's a molly in that tank. I got to get it out. You're feeding. And then by the end of the time you're feeding 70 tanks, which is like 25 minutes later, it's like, I got to get out of here. I got to go. I forget about the fish. And I come home in the afternoon, like, it's gone. They ate the whole thing. So they can take care of dead things in your tank, including dead plants, dead fish. Yep. Like I said, they're interesting to look at. Now, the other thing to consider is they're a food source for a lot of fish. And that's also one of the ways to get rid of them if you have too many snails. Obviously, a lot of the loaches will eat them. That's why people sometimes get loaches. Like, yep, got a snail problem. Threw some loaches in there. A month later, there wasn't a single snail to be found. But there's a lot more fish that eat them. And so in our fish room, we don't make any attempt at all to avoid snails from getting into a tank. It's impossible. We've got gravel vacs going from one tank to another. We're using fish nets, you know, that are going between tanks. So the likelihood that we're able to eliminate snails in a tank is zero. If they're not in a tank, it's because the fish in that tank or some fish in that tank will eat them. So examples of fish that really like to eat snails besides the loaches. Pretty much most medium to large size Central and South American cichlids. I don't think I have any snails in any tank where we have that going on. Medium to the geophagus, rainbow cichlids. I think when the curviceps were in there, we had none. You know, some of the smaller ones, like maybe rams and epistles, they might not eat them as much, but certainly any South Central American that's medium to large size, most likely they're going to control your snail populations. I have found a lot of the Lake Malawi African cichlids, like all my peacock tanks, my Mbuna tanks, there really aren't any snails in there either. So they're taking care of them pretty well. So that's an option. One of the things that I used to love to do was feed tinfoil barbs, the ballast sharks, and silver dollars. Really liked to snack on snails. And so that was kind of interesting. So there's some non-cichlid fish besides loaches that will eat them. If you've got a larger tank, most puffers, obviously you mentioned your pea puffers, they like to eat them as well. Although some, you found that some of them, if they're, the pea puffers won't eat like intact snails, right? At least yours won't.
I have quite a number of them.
You have to prepare them by just going, right? And yeah. Then they eat the heck out of them. But so some people's pea puffers are like, yep, they just eat it. And they just break them open and suck out the juice. And others,
mine are very timid.
Yeah, they're just like, no, I just think I need you to make it for me. So they've become really dependent. They're kind of like that teenage kid that's never going to leave the house.
They love their mommy.
They're like a 35-year-old that lives in the basement. That's what you turn your pea puffers into, is wholly dependent upon mommy to feed them the snails that they need in the form that they need them. So
whoever loves pea puffers,
yeah,
you're with me, right?
Yeah.
Do whatever they need. I dress them. Buy them things.
Sure.
Take them out. Whatever they want.
Absolutely. Peter, thank you so much for the super chat. Appreciate it. Hi, great work. Two questions. How do you breed nerites, and what snail eats hair algae, if any? Nerites need brackish water. And so as long as you set up a brackish water tank, they're going to breed. Because the nerite snails, one of the downsides to them that we talked about in the mystery snail versus nerite snail video is the nerite snails, the females, will leave those little white eggs all over the place, all over glass, all over plants, all over your decorations. And they don't hatch in fresh water. They don't survive, but they just lay these eggs everywhere. If you've got a brackish water tank, well, now those little tiny eggs, they can survive and they'll breed and hatch and should work out fairly well. So that's the way I would handle that. In terms of the green hair algae, part of it depends on the number of snails that you have in a tank. So for instance, in that 20-gallon long that I mentioned, there's got to be still probably 25 or 30 mystery snails, at least in a 20-gallon long. There isn't a single strand of green hair algae anywhere in that tank. Interestingly enough, the 20-gallon right next door that houses our Julidochromis ornatus used to be, that aquascape was like so awesome until it got overran with green hair algae, and they breed in there. So I'm not really, it's like, fine, okay, it's a breeding tank. They can have that area and it's going to be covered in green hair algae. But what's interesting is we have like three or four mystery snails in that tank, and they have not been able to keep that green hair algae under control. So it really depends, in my opinion, on the number of mystery snails you have and how hungry they are. I have found a better way to control green hair algae, if you can, are Neocaridina shrimp. They generally do a pretty good job of that. And if you're looking for fish, Florida flagfish are really good at that as well. Sometimes, like we had sailfin mollies that did a really good job, but then like the black mollies don't touch it. So that's how I deal with the green hair algae. And of course, most cichlids will like to chomp on it too.
And we don't really have nerite snails, do we?
We haven't had them in a while. The last time we had them was in the 20-gallon plant to take with the fake background, but it's been a little while. We'll have to get some because I actually do want to breed them just because I think it would be fun to set up a brackish water tank and just make a bunch of baby nerite snails just because. Okay, so control. Control. You must learn control. Movie? Well, you always just say it out loud, and then the people don't get the chance to pipe in and say what movie it was. Okay, controlling them. Let's just say you're one of those people. We're like, you know what? You haven't sold me on the snails. I've got the ram's horn and the pest snails and the bladder snails and the blazing trumpet snails, and I don't like them. There's too many. So things you can do. Number one thing, and I know this is not anything new, but it's probably the most effective way to control your snails, and that is control the amount of food that they have. In my opinion, this actually isn't hard to do if you're dealing with a tank with fish. Especially if you've got bottom feeders like bristlenose plecos or Cory cats or anything that's going to feed off the bottom, geophagus. If you can control the food and just watch the tank and make sure, okay, the food that I'm putting in the tank is being eaten by the fish and it's not being left behind. Once you do that, over time, it's not going to happen overnight. So a lot of people are like, yeah, I did what you said. I just made sure I fed my fish really good and just fed them for 2 weeks and the snails aren't going down. It's going to take some time. It took a while for that population to build. It's going to take a little while for that population to go down, and so it might take a couple months, but if you really control the feeding, you're going to be in pretty good shape. The problem is, and I think where most people run into an issue, is when you have a shrimp tank. When you have a shrimp only tank, and it's like, well, that becomes more challenging because I am feeding the shrimp, and of course the food that I feed is sinking to the bottom, and now it's a free-for-all. I've got a pile of snails here, I've got the shrimp trying to get in. And in that particular case, yes, it becomes a little bit more problematic. And so we have to move to other types of mechanisms. And so besides controlling the food, if you can add the predators like we already talked about, assassin snails, which we briefly mentioned, they will usually preferentially target the snails over the shrimp. But there's no guarantee that they're not going to get a hold of some shrimp every once in a while. I have found, at least for me, and maybe someone's got a better idea, you can put that in the chat. But when it comes to shrimp tanks and snails, sometimes what you have to do is put something in there like a piece of cucumber or a piece of rapache. Let the snails, it won't take them long. The snails are actually pretty quick. When that food gets in there, they will form a big pile of snails on that cucumber or on the rapache or something that's some kind of a sinking food. And then you just manually remove that pile of snails. Now, are you going to remove them all? No, but if you did that every single day, what's nice is typically when you put your hand in there and you go to remove whatever pile of snails you have, the shrimp go away. They're like, man, there's a big hand coming. I'm out of here. And they move really fast. And the snails are like, I'm getting out of here too, but can't move. Right? And so you can get a lot of those snails out of there doing that. The one cool thing, you look like you want to say something.
I have a question. I'm just going to raise my hand. Then you know that my hand is raised for when you're done.
Talk to the hand. So anyway, the really cool thing, and I did a video about this, and now I feel horrible because I did this video. I showed how well this contraption worked, and now I can't find it anywhere on the internet. It was a Sarah branded snail trap, and people actually accused me on that video, like, that those results aren't real. You faked it. I'm like, why would I do that? Are you serious? I'm going to sit around for like 2 hours and pick snails off and chuck them in this trap? For what reason? What good does that do anybody? But this thing.
Shame on you.
I know. This thing was awesome. It's basically a plastic box. And in the box, you put a piece. I think they did like the Sarah food nips or whatever those things were. And then they had like this comb that was on an angle. And the snails could go in. But there was no way for them to get back out. And when I pulled this thing out after doing this thing overnight, it was jam-packed full of snails. And so if you can find that thing, I promise you, at least in our case, I have never seen anything that worked as well as that Sarah branded snail trap. And now that I finally found something that's magnificent, it's like one awesome thing they put on the market and you can't find it anymore. Like half the new stuff they put on the market, it's like, here's a new heater. Yeah, that broke after 2 weeks. Oh, here's a new light. Yeah, that lasted 6 months. And then there's something that's really awesome and it's nowhere to be found. So those are all options to get your snails out of a tank. You had a question.
Yeah, was it Empire Strikes Back or Return of the Jedi?
That would have been Empire Strikes Back. Thank you very much. Why, did somebody say it, or did you ruin the whole thing?
We had a lot of people guessing.
Why is my chat all messed up? My chat down here is fine. I see Fish Nerd. Hello, Carlos. And this one.
Hey, Carlos.
And then in my main chat over here, I don't see Carlos or the Fish Nerd. It's like stuck. So I'm sorry. The thing is stuck today. So, yeah, snails, totally awesome. Let's take some questions, because...
Oh, Filigree Aquatics says $26 on eBay.
For the Sarah snail trap?
What?
That seems expensive. I remember... I mean, it is really good, and it absolutely worked for us, but...
How many tanks do I have? How many do I need to order?
Yeah, right. Well, you only need one. That's the cool thing, is you put the food in there, stick it in there. It will trap 100 snails easily, if not more, and then you just move it from tank to tank as it goes. All right, now we've got the whole thing going on here. All right, we got a bunch of questions. We got some super chat thing, questions we have to get to. So, right. Answered Peter's, right? I think I did that one. What else do we got?
Okay, from Dave from Iowa, I'm cycling my first tank 20 gallon, planning on using snails. Which would you recommend, and how many?
So, here's what I might do. With that 20 gallon, it's probably going to be easier and cause you less stress and also make it a lot faster to use a beneficial bacteria adder. Now, we are sponsored by Fritz Aquatics. I want to make that super clear. And I always mention the Fritzzyme 7 because then you can just add the beneficial bacteria and be done with it. You can add the snails, but then I'm not going to spend money because snails generally are somewhat sensitive to ammonia. And so I'm not going to spend money on snails if I don't have to, just to put them in there. And then you're going to get an ammonia spike, and then they're probably not going to make it. And trust me, when snails die, it's messy, right? And so for those of you who have kept snails, you know, one of the ways, if you've got a lot of them, like, oh, that snail hasn't been moving. And then a couple of days later, you're like, why is the body and the shell no longer together? And then it's like you got to pull the body out. So trust me, it's just easier to get the beneficial bacteria additive. And then once you add that, you can add some snails in there and just let that bacteria build up. That would be a good way to do it, as opposed to using fish, just in case. Finn Wiggles, thank you so much for the number one fan sticker. Love that little jumping guy.
Thank you.
Justin, thank you so much for the super chat. Can I put one Neolampilagus Lelupi or a Julie as a centerpiece in a 10-gallon with 4 Neolampilagus similis? If it were me, I wouldn't. Those fish, especially the Lelupi, they get fairly aggressive. They get pretty large too. I mean, the Lelupi, a male, can top out at a solid 3 inches or so. And sometimes they can be not nice. I would say in my 33 long, where I've got that lake tank and you can set up, the Lelupi are probably the fish that everybody's like, yeah, we're not gonna mess with these guys. They're in a bad mood, especially in a 10 gallon. If you do that, the similis fry aren't going to survive, and you really want to try to build up that colony, then you can start selling off those babies. So that would be, that's just what I would do. I would probably just leave the similis in there. Trust me, once they start breeding, the problem you're going to have is you're going to have to remove fry pretty often just so that you can control the numbers in that smaller size tank. All right, there was another super chat that I saw that had a question.
Desert Fish.
Okay.
Okay. Hi, JJ. Got my first 3-pack of Cotypunks in a 29-gallon. Any breeding tips?
Yeah, make sure you got a male and a female. Give them some time. Make sure that they're of an adult size and just let them be. I basically had a bunch of rocks. I mean, if you look at the Cotypunk video that I did, I just had some flags. It was a very simple setup. Just some flagstone in there, some shells, mostly for the babies. They're not going to breed in there. They're not true shell dwellers. But a little bit of time, good water parameters. If you want to feed them the occasional bloodworms, I love to feed even the adult Cotypunks live baby brine. I think that does a good job of getting them into the breeding condition a little bit earlier. And once the fry hatch, live baby brine. And you will hopefully have somewhere between 20 and 30 little fry guys swimming around after some time. Okay, what else we got here? I'm seeing all kinds of questions. Okay, hold on. Riddle said, Legend Fish Tanks, to make it easier for Jason and Joanna, try adding. Yeah, again, and thank you so much for all of you who are doing that. If you have specific questions, it's always easier when you add the @PrimetimeAquatics, because then, at least on my screen, everything pops up orange, and I know to key in on that, and those orange blocks are questions that people would like to see answered. Send Fins, thank you so much for becoming a Primetime partner. So glad you're here. Hope you enjoy the experience. All right.
The snaily experience.
Yeah.
Wait, here's one.
Okay.
This is from Amanda Baker. Hey, Amanda. Any tips on controlling limpets? Got ram's horns under control with an assassin, but don't seem to eat limpets.
I don't know, because that's not generally a thing that I've dealt with, so I'm not exactly sure.
What's a limpet?
It's...
Well, I don't think I've ever heard of them.
Yeah. Hold on. Because that's a slang term, and I want to make sure that I'm telling you the right thing. So let me just go call a timeout here and look it up on the internet, because...
Well, here's a food question while you're okay. While you're looking that up from Connor. Hey, Connor. What is your favorite flake food for community fish? And what is your favorite frozen food other than bloodworms? Also, how do you clean wood from outside? And what wood to use?
Well, that's a lot of questions. Okay, so my favorite... Oh, look at that.
They look like
Yeah, cats. So favorite food. We are sponsored by Northfin Food, so we've been using the Northfin Community Flakes for probably close to a year and a half now, exclusively. Really, really like the consistency. I like the fact that, you know, one of the things that they claim, and I wasn't really sure about the claim initially, is like, well, you know what, your fish are probably going to produce less waste because there's less binders in our food, there's more nutrition, and therefore they're going to be able to utilize that nutrition a little bit easier. I was like, all right, let me see if that's true. And I don't have a scientific study to back that up, but it did seem like our fish were producing less waste because of the less binders and things. So that's what we use. Frozen foods, I do like bloodworms. For the most part, there's really only two that I really like, and that's bloodworms and the frozen brine shrimp. Some of the other stuff, like krill, you know, when it's frozen, it gets really oily, so you got to make sure you rinse it. I've fed out plankton recently, and that can be good for smaller fish. Just to answer your question, man, I don't know, because I don't think I've ever had limpets in my in my tanks before, so it's I'm weird. Not sure how
I've
to get rid of those.
Never even heard of them. How yeah. exciting for me!
Wait, hold on. We had food, frozen food. What was the third part?
I've lost it.
Well, all right, well, you get back to that.
How do you clean favorite frozen food other than
bloodworms? Oh, driftwood.
And how will you clean wood from outside, yeah, and what wood to use?
So we've got an entire video on how to prepare driftwood. I am not a super great expert because I don't live in a climate where we would have like access to a lot of driftwood. And so I only feel comfortable getting driftwood from a store that I know has been thoroughly dried. And so from nature, I'm probably not the best person to ask, at least in terms of finding driftwood on the ground and be like, yep, this will be a good piece.
But our friend Mike, he actually swears by putting birch in
the
tank.
But even some of that, yeah, it's got to be dried properly, because right, even that can release some of the sap.
Yeah.
Danielle, thank you so much for the sticker. Really
thank
appreciate
you.
It. Glad you're here. Hold on, let's answer some snail questions here. Claire asks, for a new beginner, what snails would you recommend in a community tank? Also, would they be okay with tetras, corys, and guppies? Yeah. So I think those fish are great. I think the two main ones are the mystery snails and the nerite snails. I personally prefer mystery snails just because they're not going to lay those eggs. And by the way, with mystery snails, it's really easy to control their breeding. And because what the mystery snails do is, if they do breed, they're going to lay the egg clutch right above the water line in your tank. And you're going to, it's going to be unmistakable. It's going to be this big, like thumb-sized egg clutch. It's going to either be probably on the lid of your aquarium or on the glass right above the waterline. So if you don't want those babies to hatch, one, if they dry out, they're not going to hatch. And two, you can just remove the egg clutch and be like, eh, that goes in the garbage, or whatever you want to do, and you're not going to get babies. And so I prefer the mystery snails. I think it would work out pretty well with what you've got going on in the tank. The other thing I saw, I don't remember who asked the question, but I wanted to answer because it was about snails, and that is, can you keep mystery snails with bettas? And
I've never had a problem.
Yeah. So I think you've done that in almost in every betta tank that you've got. You've got the combination.
Even with some of my spunkier bettas, I've never had a problem with a mystery snail. I don't even have a problem with the pea puffers and a mystery snail.
Yeah, amazingly enough. I mean, there's some weird combinations that we've done, not on purpose.
Right.
That was one of them. And it's just the mystery snails are so big and the puffers are so small. They're like, puffers are like, all right, I don't think this is food. Plus, but again, your puffers are weird.
They are.
Because they won't eat snails unless you pre-crush the shells. And so they get the double whammy of like, what is this gigantic thing? I mean, could you imagine like you walking down the street and all of a sudden this hamburger comes that's like five times the size of you?
Mm-hmm.
Would you try to eat that?
Well, the question
a hamburger.
Would be...
That's the question. Would you try to eat a hamburger That's five times your size.
No, that gives me the willies. But I don't think Eenie and Meenie would.
I hate those names. I do. I'm sorry. And
he actually, do you know that he actually edited that out of the video? Their names, because he does not like their names. How can you not like Eenie?
I don't know why. Eenie and Meenie. Stop, because I don't know why I don't like those names. Yeah, we did the Puffers versus the Sparkling Gourami video, and you said that in part of the video. I'm like, that's going out. I cringe. I don't know why. You know how people have those words that are, like, a long time ago, people did like a non-swear swear word thing, like where there are certain words that bother people. Like one of them is the word moist, mm-hmm. Which. Whatever, but at that, you're Eenie. No.
Yeah.
Clint, thank you. On another note, on a happy note, Clint, thank you so much for the super chat. Thanks, appreciate Clint. You being here. Glad you're here. And Carrie, thank you so much for the sticker. Yay. Appreciate that too. Thank you so much.
Wait, I have a question here. I caught my name somewhere here.
Okay, well, while you're looking at that, so anyway, to answer the question, bettas and mystery snails, we haven't had any problems. We've done it at this point dozens of times, but there are people who say, oh, you know what, I tried it, mm-hmm. and my betta just kept picking at the mystery snail. So it really depends on the personality of your betta. You just got to be careful and make sure you've got a backup plan.
Okay, Minister Brandon wanted to know what my favorite color mystery snail is. I'd have to say blue.
You like the blues?
I do.
We've got the magentas that I really like. Those are my favorites.
But we don't have purple. Purple, in fact, would be pretty cool.
I think the blues are maybe out of the ones that we have. They probably come in third place out of the three. Because we've got the blues and the golds. We've got blues, golds, and the magentas. I think I like the magentas, then the golds, then the blues. And there's other really cool ones too. Those are just the ones that we currently are breeding right now. Mm-hmm. Let's see here. I saw more. Okay, hold on. Yo-yos and rainbows. I've got bladder snails to feed my pea puffer. Figure eight, clown loaches don't seem to be reproducing. Now none for pea puffer. Clown loaches, figure eight, aren't interested in them. So when it comes to, hey, I ran out of snails for my puffers, generally speaking, if I throw in a handful of pest snails, ram's horn snails, and just feed them stuff like sinking pellets and high protein foods, give it some time and they just start going nuts. Usually that's how it works for us.
Hey, Eric's here. Hey, Eric.
What's up, Eric?
He wants to know, have you ever used frozen cyclops?
I have. And from what I can remember, that's really tiny stuff. And so that's something where, from what I can remember, at least the frozen cyclops that I had to put it in a tank, and it was almost like little tiny pieces of powder that I wound up feeding to some of my fry. And I saw another question in here, and again, I'm sorry because this thing is starting to move. Mystery snails in fry tanks. Absolutely. I mean, that's something I think a lot of people do, is they will put mystery snails in their fry tanks because they can kind of clean up some of the uneaten food. And they generally don't. I've never seen a mystery snail try to take down like a live fish. Could you imagine like the mystery snail chasing the fish around, and like after about 5 minutes, the mystery snail is just kind of like, I need to take a breather here. This isn't working. So yeah, I guess the only caveat to that is like maybe if you had like fry that were super lazy just sitting on the bottom, but I've never had an issue with that combination. So geek mashup, hold on. I am having problems with mystery snails and a betta. What can I do to calm the betta and stop it from nipping? When that problem arises, usually what I have found is when that problem happens, the betta was there first. And if you try to add the mystery snail in after that, that's often when I see the few issues that we've had, that's usually when it happens. And so usually when we're setting up the tanks, I always tell you to add the fish and the betta, or add the betta and the snail at the same time, or add the snail first. Mm-hmm. That, as weird as it sounds, cuts back on that. So that's one. I know a while ago we did a video on fish jail and whether or not fish timeouts work. Generally speaking, I've never seen that work, but it's something potentially where if I was having that combination of a mystery snail and a betta, I might consider removing the betta for a few days and putting it in a different tank and then trying to put it back in and see if it will now ignore the mystery snail. Like, oh, this is part of it's a moving rock. Okay, I'm just going to leave that alone.
Really? So you're saying that betta have short memories?
They do have tiny brains.
They're so pretty, though.
They are.
Cute and sweet.
That's okay, but still the brains are lacking. Carlos, the fish nerd, thank you so much for the super chat, my man. Planning a 75-gallon Ambuna community tank. That's going to be cool. Whoa. What species would you combine with lots of color? Really like the ACI. Yeah, the ACI are cool. With the ACI, what's interesting about them is they like to, more than any other Ambuna, they like to kind of be together in school. With that, I would do my best with the ACI because they get so big. I mean, the males are some of the bigger Ambuna out there. If you can, try to do one male to multiple females, because when the bigger males really start getting going in a 75-gallon, sometimes there isn't enough room for them to kind of sort things out, even with an oversized tank or overstocked tank. So the ACI are cool. That's going to give you your blue and yellow. Certainly the yellow labs are going to be awesome. Pseudotrophia solosi is going to give you a little bit more yellow and some more blue. I like the red zebras. I think those things work out pretty well in a tank like that. The rusty cichlids. So we're staying with cichlids because you like the ACI that are the Ambuna that are going to be a little bit less aggressive. And I think that's a pretty cool combination that would work out really well. So, but yeah, I can't wait to see that on your, if you post a video, I want to see that tank because it's going to be cool.
And is this your tank or your wife's?
Yeah, right. Hold on, Whips World. Riddle me this. Oh, boy. If I have a running quarantine tank, 29-gallon, currently with no fish, but hundreds of snails, is that enough biological activity to keep the nitrogen cycle intact? Absolutely. That's one of the things that I use. It's not in a 29, but in our 10 gallons. Feed them, though, right? You're going to want to feed the snails and let them do their thing. But that's a lot of times in our quarantine tanks, I'll either keep a bristlenose pleco, one in there, or I just let the snails do their thing, but I make sure every day I give them flake food or give them a little bit of sinking pellets just so that they're eating, they're producing the waste. The other heterotrophic microbes are breaking that stuff down, producing ammonia and still doing an ammonia cycle. Now, will they produce enough ammonia if you had like, oh, I just got 10 juvenile cichlids, now I'm going to chuck them all in a 10-gallon or something. You might have some issues there, but they will definitely keep some beneficial bacteria going for sure.
It's okay. Carlos's tank.
All right. Well, that's good to know.
Now we know.
Yep. And now we know. Okay.
No MTS yet for his wife.
Let's see here. Let's see. Noah asks, in the Ambuna tank you just talked about, what kind of bottom feeders would you add in? That's a great question. Mm-hmm. So what I have in that tank right now is bristlenose plecos, because I guess they're not like catfish or anything, but they are going to consume. In an Ambuna tank, I'm more worried about algae control than I am anything falling into the substrate, because Ambuna are nuts. They are absolutely crazy. I don't think a single flake ever hits the bottom of my tank, and it doesn't matter how much I throw in there. If you're using sand, first of all, they're going to eat everything. Those fish are just absolutely crazy. So you could put cynodontis. In fact, I think I do have one Cynodontis petrocola, dwarf petrocola, in that tank. It kind of hides in the rocks, which has always worked out fine. So Cynodontis is an option if they've got some hiding spots. Bristlenose plecos are definitely can be a good mix if they've got some hiding spots. They'll come out at night, clean up the algae. The problem with the bottom feeder is unless they're really quick, like the Cynodontis, they're probably not going to get any like actual food unless you feed them at night after the lights go off. Let's see. Collins Critter Cave, thank you so much for the sticker. Appreciate it. Minister Brandon, thank you so much for the super chat. Tuck to the hand, Valentine's reminder for life. Did I not? We went out for Valentine's Day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We did, actually.
That was pretty fun.
And I even got to choose if we bring the boys with or not.
Yep. Jesse asks, when hatching baby brine, after 24 hours, I seem to get a nice hatch. Yeah, that's how long I do it for as well. Am I able to leave what I don't feed in the hatcher for another 12 hours with air until the next feeding? You can, but what tends to happen after around 24 hours is, believe it or not, the live baby brine start to lose some of their nutritional value as they consume what's left of the nutrients that they had when they hatched. By the time you get to 36 hours, a lot of times what you're left with is live baby brine that's got a lot of exoskeleton and not as much nutritional value. So that would be the only problem. So you might want to just, if you want to feed twice a day, like we do, just make two small, I have a video on how to DIY live baby brine hatcheries just using a 1 liter bottle. It costs basically zero money. And I hatch it out twice a day and just hatch out smaller amounts. So start one in the morning, and then every 24 hours in the morning, we feed that one out. And then we've got an evening bottle that we feed out every evening. That will be the better way to do it. Okay, let's see here. Kevin asks, Joanna, when you set up new, I think it's supposed to say nano tank, when do you add shrimp after? So how long, so I'm guessing this question is how long do we wait to add the shrimp after setting up a tank? We do it right away.
Yeah.
Right? I mean,
as long as we've added the Fritzheim 7.
Yep. Or cycled filter medium.
Yeah.
Yep.
We frequently are reusing the filter medium.
Yep. Yeah. So either one of those things, either add the live nitrifying bacteria or use filter media from another tank, and then I don't wait. And that's been the way it has been for everything that we've done. But we also aren't throwing in like 15,000 fish in a tank and be like, yeah, we added the Fritzheim and this little bit of used filter media, but the tank is brand new, and then we wind up with a problem. So the trick there is add the fish slowly. Okay. Lobie's Planet?
Lubies Planet.
What's your opinion on the Jack Dempsey, and what's the minimum tank size for a single male that isn't a 55 gallon? I like Jack Dempseys, and when I don't know how many people actually have appreciated a Jack Dempsey in person that is full grown, but it is one of the most striking fish when it is showing full color. In my opinion, I like them on a dark substrate with a dark background. They really get that dark blue iridescence. Full grown, they're amazing fish. If it was the only fish in my tank, maybe you could get away with a 40 gallon breeder, but if it was the only fish, if you want to start adding other fish to the tank, you're going to need at least a 75 gallon, because they get their name for a reason. They can be a little bit rough on other fish, but they're absolutely amazing. And it's one of my memories as a child. My uncle was breeding Jack Dempseys, and he was going away on a vacation. I just remember as a kid, I don't have like the full memory anymore, but I remember my uncle and my dad, they transported these Jack Dempseys in like a plastic garbage can, and they brought them into the living room, and then they were just netting them out and throwing them in a temporary tank, so I guess that we could watch them. And it was just cool because they were there, like, from what I can remember as a kid, for like a week or two. But I was just like, wow, these are the coolest fish I've ever seen, because we were used to just keeping like regular, you know, tetras and hatchet fish and stuff like that. And yeah, Jack Dempseys were really cool. Yep. All right, what else? What else we got here? You're supposed to be, you know, doing the whole...
Well, yeah, but you're like talking and stuff.
All right, well, I'll stop, and then you can just find the things.
Uh-huh.
All right, let me scroll up.
Here's a good one. I think I know the answer to this one. Okay. Here. Von Lurker wants to know, can I throw duckweed in an Mbuna tank as an extra source of food?
You said you know the answer.
I'm going to say yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They love it.
We do that quite a bit. So there's two things I throw in Mbuna tanks for food, and that is when I get a lot of hornwort and when I get a lot of duckweed. And sometimes a salvinia, and they just... It usually goes missing within a couple days. So they eat that, and they have fun with it. I'll do the same thing with like my severums. The duckweed will go in there, as well as hornwort, and they eat that and they nibble on it. They don't necessarily eat it all, like, as a, you know, like if you were feeding fish food, but they do take care of it usually within a few days, and it's a nice salad meal for them. But the Mbuna love that stuff. So definitely a good thing to eat. It's free food. It's free fish food.
Mm-hmm.
Eric, thank you so much for the super chat. Really appreciate it. All right, here we go. Question. All juveniles. 2 Oscars, 1 Green Terror, 1 Chocolate Cichlid, 1 Flag Cichlid, 1 Severum, 3 Geos, 1 Datenoid, all getting along fine so far, and a 150. Is this too many? Can I add more? Maybe a Jack Dempsey. So I'm assuming, first of all, that we're talking about a 6 foot 150, not the 4 foot. Because if it was a 4 foot 150 like the one I have, I'd be removing everything but the 2 Oscars. If it's a 6 foot, it doesn't seem like it should make that big of a difference, but it really does. If it's a 6 foot, I think I wouldn't add any more. But I wouldn't necessarily stress just yet about taking anything out. Let that play out and see what happens. There's a couple things that might go on here. One is 2 Oscars. And so there's a couple, there's obviously three things that could happen. One, you get a pair, in which case they're going to, if they start to breed, they're going to push all of those other fish off to the side. So that could be an issue. The second thing that might happen with the two Oscars is you've got two males that don't get along, and therefore you'll have to remove one of them. Most likely you'll start to see that happen by the time they're about 8 to 10 inches, which, believe it or not, happens fairly quickly, especially in a 150. And of course, the other thing that stands out is that one green terror. Sometimes it works out, especially if it's a female. Sometimes that green terror will decide it's my tank. And if I was a betting man and I had to put money on which fish is going to run that tank over time, it will be that green terror. And the Oscars, for the most part, don't do a great job of defending themselves. So you'll have to keep an eye on that mix. Again, it might work out just fine, but it's when they get to that adult size, and if that green terror is a male, you might run into problems. If it's a female, maybe less so, and maybe not at all, right? So just some things to keep in mind, but I don't think I wouldn't add any more to that tank. I think you've got a mix that you can work with, hopefully. Let's see here. We got Truth Will Out. Thank you so much for the super chat. Oh, yeah. In the house. What is up, Primetime Aquatics? Yeah. What's up? Well, thank you for being here. Yeah, hey, you know what? I did what I could to, you know, what's funny is I saw in the comment section after last week, some of you were saying I should do an entire live stream in a Beavis and Butthead voice.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, woo! I think I'd give myself a headache. I know you'd hate me, and we'd probably be down to like 6 viewers after about 5 minutes of that. Be like, what's wrong with this guy? Did he get knocked in the head or something
have to at least alternate between that and running Stimpy.
Yeah, must have been sniffing too many aquarium chemicals or something. Let's see here. Finwiggles says, anyone taken pond snails from their outdoor ponds and brought them inside to their tanks? That's a very interesting question, actually, because that is not without a little bit of risk. Not a lot, but some parasites will use a snail as an intermediate host and will actually then, so they complete their life cycle. Some of them will go from like birds to snails to fish and back. Some of them kind of skip the bird thing, but they use the snails and the fish and maybe some other animal. So it's a really good question. Is it a huge risk? Maybe not, but there could be a risk there. And believe it or not, there are some parasites that will complete that life cycle, and the human is involved in that. So, as long as that's not happening, and again, I think it's relatively rare, but there is always that minor risk of something like that happening. So if nothing else, it might harm the fish if that life cycle completes itself. But then eventually that life cycle will die out if it doesn't have that third host. Okay, Gus asks, if I do add apple snails to my Jack Dempsey tank, do I have to feed them? The Jack Dempseys or the apple snails? Because I think the Jack Dempseys will take care of those apple snails and be like, ooh, look at that. There's a special food inside this moving rock. I'm going to go ahead and suck all that food right out and see what happens. Paul, Jason, are your serums still eating all the plants in the tank? Yes, they are still eating all the plants in my tank. And I don't try to put like regular plants in there. I don't feel like them tearing them apart. So right now I purposely feed them hornwort. I feed them duckweed. I feed them some extra salvinia from time to time, and they eat that. They don't eat it like super fast. So for instance, I had like a big mound of hornwort that I chucked in the 150, and there's the gold severum in there, and then I've got the red shoulder. I chucked that in there, and it's taken them like a month to go through it, but they are eating it. And then in the other the red spot gold severum tank, the 40-gallon breeder, I put like a softball size of hornwort in there, and they're probably 2/3 of the way through that in the last couple weeks. So yeah, they still munch on it, but that's okay. It's fine. I don't think I would plant that 150 right now anyway, because the lights aren't nearly strong enough and that tank is 30 inches deep, and I'm not really feeling like investing massive amounts of money on lights for that to do that. So, yeah. Blue Ice Aquatics asks, will you be setting up summer tubs? I won't. This one over here?
Maybe.
Maybe, yeah. But of course, it's not really going to be a tub. It'll probably be like some kind of it'll be a thing, right, on your channel. Yeah. Maybe.
A thing.
It'll be a thing, and I'll have to edit the thing and show everybody the video.
You're so not technical.
Sebastian asks, how to fight blackbird algae which grows on small gravel? That's a great question. So fighting blackbird algae that's growing on gravel.
Throw away the gravel.
There's a few things you can do there. Hydrogen peroxide works, but you have to have the gravel exposed, which means you have to remove the fish or remove the gravel, spray it down really well with the hydrogen peroxide, and then chuck it back in. That's going to be a pain because you'll have to remove a lot of the gravel to do it and stir up a bunch of stuff. My answer is somewhat unpopular because it doesn't completely eliminate the problem, and that is I don't fear the blackbeard algae. I just don't fear it. We have it in some of our tanks, and I, for the most part, make zero effort to remove it. What I do is we control it. And so sometimes I think what scares people the most is I see blackbeard algae. I've seen these videos where the entire tank is overrun with the stuff. Oh my gosh, it's going to be a catastrophe. All my plants are going to die. Everything is going to get ruined. And what I found is as long as I'm keeping up with the water changes and I'm keeping the nitrate concentrations to 20 parts per million or less, as long as I'm controlling the light to a reasonable amount and I'm controlling my feeding, the blackbeard algae is there. But it never really does what you see in some of these nightmare videos where it's growing out of control, killing all the plants, and doing all those kinds of horrible things. So that's sort of how I deal with it. Again, for us, a lot. And I mean, you have to have a lot of mystery snails in a tank where they're just constantly munching, because we've actually thrown plants that had blackbeard algae in the 20-gallon long mystery snail breeding tank, and we gave them a couple weeks and they cleared it all off. So normally it's, if you had one, I seriously doubt you would see any difference. If the tank is large enough, the other fish that will sometimes eat it are the Siamese algae eaters, not the Chinese, but the Siamese algae eaters will sometimes eat it, but they've got to be hungry enough to do so. So that's another option. Oh my gosh, we've got some super chats popping up here. Bonnie, thank you so much again. How much Fritz Complete to add to 5 gallon when changing water? I don't remember. I'm sorry. I don't have the bottle in front of me. I know the directions. They have the concentration. I think the what you're getting at is it's fairly concentrated, and so, you know, how not do you much. Measure that out? Yeah, it comes down to like just pour a little tiny bit in. I mean, I don't have like a really scientific answer for you in that small of a quantity, but usually a few drops is probably going to do it for you. But yeah, that can be a little bit with the more concentrated solutions. It's like, oh man, this says like, and I don't remember what it is because when I'm doing water changes, I use the powder. And so I just chuck the powder in there. But yeah, it's you're talking about drops at that point. Michael, thank you so much for the super chat. Appreciate it. I have my first multi-fry and they are doing great. Thanks for the inspiration. Really enjoy watching. That's awesome. That is so exciting. There is not a lot cooler in the aquarium hobby than watching those little tiny shell-dwelling fry finally gain the confidence to be like, man, you know what? There's a big world out here. I've been inside this dark little hole inside the shell, and now I'm going to swim, and I'm going to try my best. And then they go out there, and they swim a little bit, and the mom comes by and says, get back in your shell. And they'll go right back in. So one of the things you learn, and actually this is kind of strange. How many of you, I would love to hear from you, how many of you have perfected sneaking up on your tank so that you can see some of the fish that are like, human, and they're gone, right? Where you're just like, all right, you got to think this out, right? I'm going to approach it from the side. I'm going to turn off all the lights, and I'm going to very slowly approach it. They're going to think I'm a tree. You just take like one step, and if someone were to watch you from the outside, they'd be like, what is this person doing? Are they seriously like, you know, you kind of look like a cat that's sneaking up on its prey. You're like, okay, I see that pleco. I haven't seen my $500 pleco in 6 months, but there it is.
There he is.
And you're like, you're sneaking up on it. You're like, and then you're even afraid to move your head. And you're like, maybe I'm going to get a picture. And you're just like moving the phone. And you're like, oh no, the reflection's showing up. And all of a sudden the pleco's like, and phew, gone. And you're like, I didn't even get the picture. But you enjoyed it for a half second. So yeah, the multi-fry, especially when they're newer and like there's not a lot of adults out there, you got to learn how to sneak up on them so you can see them.
They are great parents.
They are. Yep. Yeah, and they're usually telling them to get back in the shells when they're young. Keith, thank you so much for the super chat. Always enjoy your very informative podcast. I am now inspired to get several celestial pearl Daniels and name them. Oh, don't do it. I'm not saying those names.
Oh, itsy bitsy teeny weeny weeny. Oh, you should.
Uh-huh. I got mixed feelings about that one. But all right. I'm glad you like the celestial pearl Daniels, and those are quite some names.
You don't like itsy or bitsy? Do you have a problem with those? Or itty bitty?
They're all great. For Keith, nice job. I like it. As long as I don't have to hear it on a video that I'm editing, you can name them whatever you want. But that's cool. Celestial pearl Daniels are awesome fish.
They are.
Let's see here. Gus asks, what type of pleco might work with a Jack Dempsey? Depends on the size tank, depends on the hiding spots, but I would have no hesitation throwing bristlenose plecos in there of any kind. Some of the higher end plecos, again, I don't often recommend higher end plecos. I'm not like an expert on the L numbers or anything like that, because I generally don't buy them. And so there's probably like a dozen of the more high end plecos, like, oh, you can do the zebra pleco, you can do this, you can do that. And it's like, I don't buy those. And so I would say most plecos that are going to be 6 inches or larger are most likely going to work, provided that they have the spots to retreat to if they're feeling a little bit threatened or the Jack Dempsey's in a bad mood. Because plecos do this wonderful thing, they come out at night and they will feed at night. And so that's the nice thing about them. Like with all my cichlid tanks, my peacock tanks, especially my ambuna tanks, I don't generally see them out that much with the lights on, but they're there. There's a couple of them in that tank, two or three, and then they come out at night and it keeps the tank nice and algae free. And if you feed them at night after the lights go off, so make sure your Jack Dempsey's been kind of sleeping for the last 15 or 20 minutes with the light off, chuck in their food if you think that they are not getting enough. And yeah, it works out okay most of the time. All right.
Dave from Iowa suggested one-way glass.
Now that would be interesting. But wait a minute, isn't usually one-way glass a mirror? It is. On the other side, so the fish would be constantly looking at it. They probably freak themselves out by looking at themselves in the one-way mirror thing. Yeah. All right, Matt asks, how many adult guppies in a 29 long with a baby common snapping turtle? Well, you can put as many as you want in there, but that baby common snapping turtle is going to eat them all. So, I don't think long, and it's mostly because the guppies are not something that's like, okay, the guppies are going to always stay at the top and the snapping turtle is just going to lay at the bottom all the time. Guppies are fish that go all over the place. And so eventually you would have most likely zero guppies, but the snapping turtle, that's cool. I would be, that's a cool thing. There was one in the road, there's been a couple on the road that were like, they were huge. And I was like, all right, I'm going to move this thing. And it's amazing how fast those guys are when they're out of the water and they don't want to be touched. Wow. Thing turned around and hissed at me. I'm like, I'm not losing a finger over this. You can sit out in the street then, buddy. And then like 2 seconds later, someone called the cops, like someone who drove by later. And the cops had these big gloves on and things hissing and going crazy. I'm like, you know what? That's fine. You can do that one. Okay.
Hey, Papa Bear said, hey, PTA. Hey, thanks for recommending CCAM Tidal. Such an awesome filter.
Awesome. Glad you like it. That's really cool.
Yay.
I like the Seachem titles. They're interesting filters in that they've got that top skimmer. And again, I like that motor that's submerged. Some people don't like that top skimmer. I don't mind it. You know, it's one of those things too. If you've got fry, you have to think about how you're going to cover the intakes. But if you don't have to worry about that, yeah, I like the filter a lot. I think it's been reliable for us. We've got the Seachem 35, the Tidal 35, and the 55. Hmm. No problems.
Well, this is an interesting comment. All right, so Joyce Brown says, I have a lot of similis babies now and love to watch the adults pick up and move any intruder snails that get too close to their shells.
Yes, absolutely.
I don't think I've ever seen any of the shellies like pick up.
They do it all the time. Yeah, especially.
Aren't they cute?
Yeah, our multis do that, or at least they did until all of the snails went missing. So what's interesting is the multis, for a while they weren't eating snails, and I was like, man, this multi tank, the 50-gallon lobo, I'm like, it's kind of getting to be a lot of snails there. Remember, you used to comment on that too, and then eventually they got to a size where they must have figured out, hey, you know what, there's a lot of us in here and the food is, we have to compete for it, so we're gonna go eat these juicy things. And but I used to see them all the time. They pick them up and spit them out, and it was just, it's something for them to do. It's work. You know, it's a living. So, James says, love my Mbuna tanks, but I have one male Kenyi by himself and a 20 long, super playful and super happy. But now at the four to five inch mark, does he need to be moved? My parameters stay perfect. Yeah, probably. I mean, he's probably, because they're active, right? The Mbuna are so active, you might want to consider moving them to a longer tank. It doesn't necessarily have to be, if you got them at 20 long, it's not going to do any good really to move them to a 29. Yeah, the Kenyi, I've got some Kenyi in my mixed Mbuna tank. I think it's worked out fairly well, but that male Kenyi runs that tank. He's definitely the guy. He's not like evil about it or anything. He's just like, okay, you see this big rock here in the center, everybody? This rock is mine. And he spends his time trying to chase away 25 other fish. And of course, he can't really spend any time on one. So he's just constant like, and it's not even the whole rock. It's just the back rock closest to the back. He's like, this is mine. So yeah, they're interesting fish. I like them. So go ahead.
Amanda wants to know, any tips on repairing a cracked shell? Super glue?
I have seen people do that. Yeah, I have seen people use a super glue gel to do that. And I don't know of any other way to do it. And I'm not even saying 100%. I've never done that.
What would happen when the snail shell continues to grow? Would it re-crack or?
I don't know, because I haven't done it. So I'm not sure how that works. I'm not sure the long-term viability of that solution. So if somebody else has done it, love to hear from you. But yeah, and Aquatics, hey, fish family, thanks for all the help and advice. Well, thank you for being here. Glad you are here hanging out with us. Yeah. All right, let's see. Let's take a few more questions, half a dozen or so.
I can't believe it's after 9 already.
Yeah, time flies when we're having fun, right?
Yeah.
Let's see here. Legend Fish Tanks. Can one blue Acara live with a breeding pair of caudalpunks in a 29-gallon? If it were me, I probably wouldn't do that because you've got the breeding pair. And for the most part, blue Acara are not predatory fish, but they absolutely will eat any fish that they can fit in their mouth. So you're going to possibly have two issues going on there. One is caudalpunks, they're not messing around when they have... When they've got babies, they'll get those stripes and they'll get angry and head down and they will start chasing fish around. And they are even though they're smaller, they are much more aggressive than the electric blue Acara, and they will push that fish into a corner and not let him out. Then the issue is going to be if he survives that and gets bigger, he will start picking off the fry because the fry are tiny, right? So he's like, oh, look at that little tiny swimming thing. They just go pow, 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 and eventually start picking them off. But it's going to be a battle because he'll come down, he'll pick them off while they're not looking, they'll chase him away. And so I think what you'll wind up having is a tank that you don't like, that you won't enjoy. I think it'll be stressful for you. And so if I'm breeding caudalpunks, that's the purpose of that tank, because other fish in there are just either going to get beat up or eat the fish, and it's just going to be a big thing that I don't want to see.
Amanda Henson wants to know, can mystery snails change gender? I keep seeing conflicting info.
Not that I'm aware of. I don't remember seeing that, but again, I'm not a complete mystery snail expert, but I don't remember any real evidence like, oh yeah, this, that they switch. So, but I'm also not like 100% putting my foot down, like, no, that's crazy talk. But I don't remember that ever being a thing. I thought that they were either males or females, and that was it.
Okay.
Yep. Let's see here. Scrolling on down, looking for the orange boxes. Camden asks, how many adult angels can go in a 55, and how many rams also? So anytime you're keeping cichlids, you have to be concerned with, when you keep more than one, you get a pair, they start breeding, they're going to start pushing other fish to the side, right? I would probably feel, if it were me setting that up, to be safe long-term. I'm always thinking long-term. Lots of stuff work. Like I could tell you, yeah, go ahead and put a half a dozen angelfish and a half a dozen rams in that 55. And at first it's going to work. It will absolutely work because their angels are going to be small. They're going to be like little puppy dog angels. They're going to be super excited when it's time to eat, and they're all going to get along, and then they're going to grow to adult size, and now they're going to either start pairing up, or you're going to get multiple males, and there's going to be potential issues, not guaranteed, but there might be issues later on. And so in a 4-foot tank like a 55, you could easily get away, most likely get away with, in a heavily planted tank, maybe a couple males, and females as well. But if they pair up, then you might have to start dealing with that. If it were me, long term, I might feel most comfortable. And again, it's all about, you want to enjoy the tank. You don't want to have to be managing issues later on. And the guaranteed way to not have issues, or at least minimize your issues, is I might do an angel, like a really cool one, like maybe a blue angel or some really pretty veil tail. And then I might do maybe, I don't know, maybe 4 to 6 rams. A 4-foot tank should give them enough space where if they start pairing up, they can get far enough away from each other where it's not going to be an issue. And maybe if you get 2 pairs, you might have to think about, okay, what am I going to do with the extra fish that are kind of getting caught in the middle? Of course, you can avoid that if you've got a male and maybe 3 or 4 females. The females tend not to be as hard on one another, and so that might work. And then if you do get a breeding pair, they're off to the side.
Lav has confirmed they do not change.
Thank you, Lav. Yeah, I didn't think so, and I've heard that before, and I'm like, I remember reading nothing about them being able to do that. Jerry, thank you so much for the super chat. Do snails eat ick, eggs, or larvae? Not in any way that's going to be meaningful. So could they graze on it? Maybe, but just remember, when it comes to ick, the parasite itself is going all over the place. And most of the time it settles in the substrate. And that parasite is absolutely tiny. So even if you're dealing with sand, the likelihood that the snail is going to be eating that little tiny parasite that's falling even between sand granules is very unlikely. And so they would have no impact on it whatsoever, because it multiplies so rapidly that there's just nothing they could do about it, especially in a closed system like what we're dealing with here in a fish tank. Let's see here. What else? Fishy business. Hey, I'm looking into getting some dwarf pikes. Can I keep them with an Beckford eye and a pistos and a 280? Also, any love for Biotodoma cupedo? Yes, I like the Biotodoma a lot. Your dwarf pike cichlids. First of all, the tank is going to be great. It's a 280 gallons, so I'm assuming that is probably, what, an 8-foot tank, 7 or 8-foot tank. They are predatory, though. And so the Beckford eye are decent size. The cupids are also pretty big. I mean, they're going to be 4 to 5 inches. The dwarf pikes, what are they going to get? Maybe 7, 8 inches, maybe 9 tops, but they've got a really big mouth. They're also somewhat aggressive. If it was set up correctly where I had some rock work and maybe some, you know, fake plants or something like that where the other fish could kind of hide out, maybe I might try that with the dwarf pikes. But there's always a chance that maybe they become a little bit too aggressive and take it out on those fish and wind up causing problems later on. But yeah, that 280 is going to be, that's going to be an awesome tank, man. I wish I could get a tank that large down in the in the basement.
Yeah.
Eric asks, common snail diseases. Common snail diseases. I don't know if it's necessarily a disease, but I think the most common thing you have to consider is not having enough carbonate in the water. I don't really come across like any communicable diseases in snails. They're not susceptible to ick or anything like that. But I think probably one of the biggest issues when it comes to snails is if you don't have proper water hardness, and what I'm talking about is carbonate hardness, then that's when you start to see the shells start to get thin. They start to almost look translucent a little bit, or they start to whiten, which can be a problem. You might start to see shells cracking. So I think that's a good question. I think that's probably the number one thing that to consider if you're going to keep snails is making sure that you have the proper carbonate hardness to make sure that they're going to be okay. Okay. Fat Man, thoughts on Tums as a calcium carbonate supplement? Yeah, people use it. It works. You can also use the baking soda that we talked about. But again, you got to be super careful with this stuff. So I've said it a million times, but I always recommend when you're going to be adding stuff like that, that's going to increase carbonate hardness, or, you know, if you're adding anything for general hardness or pH, do it in a tub without living things, because you want to see what that's doing to your water parameters before you start throwing stuff in a tank and you've got living things and you're like, oh wow, that just messed up my whole tank, right? Okay, let's see here. Jack says, well guys, it's been real. It's Netflix time. Have a good night. I hope you enjoy your Netflix, man. Thanks for being here. Appreciate it. All right, let's take two more questions. What do you say? A couple more? Who's got some? Let's find some good ones here. Are you on your game here? Are you on the question
I
game?
I am. I think Carlos had another question.
Okay, hold on. I see it. Oh, what would you say, Carlos, fish nerd? What would you say cobalt blue zebras are similar to in temperament to the red zebras? And thanks for the suggestions. You validated my working list of options. That's cool. Yeah, I think the cobalts work fine. I have some cobalts in my 75 as well. I'm trying to think what else I've gotten there. Some of them I don't necessarily recommend. I've got the oh my gosh, Johanny in there. I've got Sokolofi. Sokolofi work really well too. If you want to have like a lighter blue cichlid, like the cobalts, the Sokolofi have worked well. There's some fish in there that I probably wouldn't do again. Like the Kenny Eye could be a little rough. Unless I had females, those tend to be fine. I've got a couple bumblebee cichlids that somebody gave me. That is not something I would recommend. The other thing is, and I just added it in there, and it actually has worked out incredibly well. I had the Therops irregularis in the 75-gallon, which isn't even an Mbuna, and it was just a really mean fish. I'm like, you know what, buddy? I think you're actually going to work out better in the Mbuna tank, and they have worked out wonderfully. They just leave each other alone, ignore each other. Don't recommend doing that, but that worked out. And then the other fish, some of the lake, if you are looking for some odd colors, like the Lake Victorians, I have found the Lake Victorians in the Mbuna, although then you're kind of ruining the whole Mbuna vibe. So if you really want to stick with that, that's fine. But I found like the zebra obliquidens, the species 35, species 44s. They're pretty aggressive and they usually fit in really well, as well as OBs. I found OBs going in Mbuna tanks without any issues as well. Last snails, you can use Tums or pure calcium carbonate for calcium. Please do not feed baking soda to your snails. Absolutely, right. Yeah, so the baking soda is really just to increase carbonate hardness. It's not something they should be really eating. So it just lessens the likelihood that they're going to leach that into the water. Let's see here. Oh, Joey asks, is there multiple strains of Malaysian trumpet snails? Yes, there are. We've got in our fish room basically what I believe to be three different types of Malaysian trumpet snails, at least three different color variations. I don't know if it's necessarily strains, but we have some that are very pale white. We have some that are brown, and then we have some that are actually not horrible looking in, mm-hmm. in one of your tanks where they've kind of got this brown and they've got some black stripes to them. They actually look somewhat kind of cool. Mm-hmm. All right. Let's see here. Let's do one more question. Let's see here. Fat Man Aquatics. Any substrate you prefer for certain breeds? I mean, snails, of course. Always sand for me. I just think that sand, when it comes to snails, especially if you're going to be feeding, especially if it's a snail-only tank, you want the snails to be able to get to the food. And what happens if you've got any average size gravel is sometimes that food is now sinking into the gravel, and now that leaves room for detritus worms and planaria that your snails aren't going to eat and all those other issues. So if you have sand, you avoid a lot of that. So sand is definitely what we prefer big time. All right, one more question. Yes, well, I feel like I just, you know, I need to do one more. Okay. Blue Ice Aquatics, here it is. What's best snails with shrimp? I have kept shrimp with pretty much all snails. And I mean, pest snails, I've kept them with ram's horn and Malaysian trumpet snails. It's just because they just got in there. We've done mystery snails and shrimp combined together before. I don't remember there being any issues with that. I've never tried nerite snails and shrimp, but I like the combination. I think it works out well because what the shrimp, they kind of complement each other in that the snails will often eat algae that the shrimp don't touch. So if it's getting on the glass or if it's getting on certain decorations, and the shrimp will take care of algae that maybe the snails aren't going to eat as much. Fin Wiggles, thank you so much for the sticker. Aww. The bye-bye sticker. Well, once you get a bye-bye sticker, you know how that works, right? So Ricky just jumped in. I'm going to answer this question. We're going to go. Glad to be back after everything that happened in Texas, but the Mrs. busted me and found a 20 long, 4 tens, and a 75. Any advice?
Get her some cute nano tanks.
That's right. Just put a couple of, you know, whatever fish or something that she likes. Just be like, hey, you know what? This was for you. This is for you. We're going to set up exactly. Let her pick out all the stuff, and you're going to be in good shape. So
that sounds like one of our shelves out in the garage.
Yeah.
Good times.
Yes, it does. So anyway, thank you so much for being here, everyone. Appreciate you hanging out with us tonight. Thank you for all the super chats. Thank you to Myrtle and doing all the work you did, and Clint.
Thanks, guys.
For being in here and taking care of business, and for all the stickers. And we will be back next week, same time, same place. Hope to see you there. Again, Friday, we got that video coming out on Primetime Aquatics. It's a very different video. Looking forward to hearing what you guys think. If you want more of it, and if you don't, that's cool too. Just love to hear what your thoughts are. So we will see you later.
That's what the thumbs down is for.
That's what the thumbs down is for. See you later.
Bye.